is, say, 1/6 or something, then it would mean that we would multiply the third column, each of the entries, by 1/6. So the one effect of multiplying by a diagonal matrix on the left and another diagonal matrix on the right is to multiply all of the rows by some fixed numbers and multiply all of the columns by some fixed number. So we've got rescaling in the row direction and rescaling in the column direction. That's what we're doing when we're going from the inverse to the inverse, basically taking this matrix and multiplying the rows by the various factorials and multiplying the columns by the other reciprocals. And that's the matrix that we get there. And presently, it's just like the original Pascal matrix, except that it has minus signs along here and also along here. So it's kind of alternating plus minus plus minus. And presently, these formulas generalize to the n by n case. If you check this, if we find that it's not a 4x4 Pascal array, but a 6x6 or 10x10 or anything like that, then we would essentially be seeing the same phenomena. And the end result would be exactly the same. Now, when we're studying linear algebra, there are all kinds of transformations, operations that we can do at the matrix level, but none of them is as important as taking the inverse. Right, so the inverse is the dominant technology, the dominant procedure that you need to do linear algebra. And generally speaking, if you have a big n by n matrix, finding its inverse is a lot of work. And without a computer, it's seriously challenging. But in this kind of a situation that we're talking about here, where we have these band matrices, it turns out that finding inverses is much simpler. And so I want to explain that in more detail. So we just looked at this matrix E that we had, which was a band diagonal matrix, or a triplet matrix, and had this expression here, in terms of this J matrix. And here was its inverse, which I told you was this matrix, and here was its expression in terms of the J matrix. And I want to explain to you how you could have obtained this without actually doing any matrix arithmetic. But really, what we only need here is polynomial arithmetic. So we're going from this non-commutative, complicated matrix arithmetic to much simpler commutative polynomial arithmetic. And why is that? So the claim is that if we take this expression in J and this expression in J and we multiply them, we're going to get the identity. Okay, let's see why that is. So here's a polynomial in J, here's a polynomial in J. The only thing you need to know is powers of J multiply the obvious way. If you have J squared and you multiply by J cubed, you're going to get J to the fifth. Okay. So if we expand this out in terms of powers of J, what are we going to get? The I times I of I. What about powers of J? This can be an I times minus J, this can be a J times I. We're going to get 0J. How many J squared do we have? Well, there's going to be a half J squared times I times a half. And a J times minus J is minus 1. And another I times a half J squared is another plus a half. So plus a half, minus 1, plus a half, that's 0. So 0 J squared. How many J cubes? Well, there's a 6 there, a minus a half, a plus a half, minus a 6. So we have nice little cancel, and we're going to get 0 J cubed. And then what about J to the fourth? Well, J to the fourth, you can check that the term is minus half J to the fourth. And then there are additional terms, there will be a J to the fifth term, and then a J to the sixth term. But crucially, in this particular situation, the J to the fourth is 0. So this thing here actually disappears because the J to the fourth is 0, and all the subsequent higher powers of J are also 0. So the end result is that the expression this times this is the identity matrix. And this is establishing that this actually is the inverse of this. And moreover, we could have obtained this just by working at the level of the polynomials. So you're given this, you want to write down an expression here so that the product is I. We could have obtained this, if we didn't know beforehand, by sort of doing it term by term, figuring out that what the coefficient of J would have to be in order to get I, then what the coefficient of J squared would have to be in order to get zeros here. So this is really a polynomial arithmetic computation that allows us to get the inverse of the matrix. Okay, so it's a very powerful trick, perhaps, or idea that's very relevant to the Fraunhofer form of the situation. So in our last video, we were talking about the sums of powers of natural numbers. We call them S of K. So S of K is the sum of I equals 1 to N of I to the K. The K is, say, 0 or 1 or 2 or whatever. And we're interested in the formula for S of K. And I showed you a somewhat novel technology that used linear algebraic ideas together with a telescoping idea of Pascal to essentially obtain a formula like this, that ultimately there's a matrix times some column of these sums, S0, S1, S2, S3, and then that equals the global power of n squared n cubed 10 to the 4th. And the matrix that's appearing over here is very much like the Pascal kind of matrix, but slightly subtly different. Okay? It's not a full Pascal kernel, it's sort of we chopped off the diagonal ones and shifted everything up. But otherwise, it's very similar, but there's also these minus signs that appear in the second diagonal. So the essence of the computation turned out to be finding the inverse of this matrix. Okay. And I told you that, well, you could just get your computer to do that. But now I want to go a step further and show you how you could actually find the inverse without really having to do a lot of linear algebraic work, even for higher dimensional situations. And the key is to understand this matrix here in a very similar way to the way we've understood the Pascal matrix in the former slide. So let's have a look at this matrix. The name is called Q. Okay, so there it is. And I want to factor this in a very analogous way to the Pascal matrix P that we did. And it turns out that you can do this. But it's slightly subtle. Okay. So what turns out to happen is that we can write this as essentially a matrix like this, which is also constant along these band diagonals. Okay, that has a very similar kind of thing. 1 along there, then minus a half along this next band, 1/6 along the next band, minus 1/24 along the next band. So those are obviously reciprocals of the factorials. Now, the diagonal matrices that appear here, these are both diagonal matrices, okay, are also similar to what we've seen before, except with a little bit of a twist. So here we have 1/1, 1/2, 1/6, the reciprocals of 0 factorial, 1 factorial, 2 factorial, 3 factorial. And over here we have just factorials, but not starting with 0 factorial. factorial. Ladder starting with 1 factorial. Starts with reciprocal 0 factorial. Here starting with 1 factorial. So it goes 1 factorial, 2 factorial, 3 factorial, 4 factorial. Over here, one just starts with 1 over 3 factorial. So there's an asymmetry, a slight asymmetry between the diagonal matrix that we're multiplying on the right and the diagonal matrix that we're multiplying on the left. They are not quite inverses. So this is not a conjugation situation like we had for the Pascal array previously. But nevertheless, it's still a very powerful decomposition because these diagonal matrices on the left and right are very easy to deal with. And this thing here in the middle is much easier to deal with than this because it has this constant along diagonal bands property. So we'll be able to exploit the same kind of thinking that we did for the Pascal array. Analyze this thing, and then analyze the inverse of the whole thing by figuring out what the inverse of this thing is. Alright, so let's give this thing a name. This is the matrix B that's in the middle of that factorization that we have here. And now we're just writing it as a linear combination of powers of J. Minus a half j plus 1/6 j squared minus 1/24 j cubed. And now here's its inverse. Its inverse is also Venn diagonal. It's 1, the identity, plus 1/2 j plus 1/12 j squared plus 0 j cubed. And we can obtain this expression, just from this expression, by just doing polynomial arithmetic together with the same crucial fact that j fourth equals 0. So we're looking for an expression that we multiply by the original one, so we're going to say I. So by mi, and here we're going to have j, so we better put a half j there so that the total number of j's that we multiply is 0. And then we put a half j, and then the number of j squared is going to be, so it's going to be 1/6 minus 1/4, so we're going to have to put that 12 here so that the total number is 0. Okay, and then what about j cubed? Then I'm going to have minus 1/24 here, plus 1/12 there, minus 1/24 there. That's already total 0.